The hearing will convene. The hearing will convene. Our witness today, a regular witness and a very welcome one, is the Secretary of HUD, who is, in my opinion, doing a very good job. We are talking now about a very important subject, which is public housing. Let me just say, when you deal with public housing, you're dealing with among the poorest people in America. And as I look at the record of public policy, one where we have the most to apologize for, and more importantly, the greatest need to improve, is in the way in which we treat the poorest people in America. We have done far too much to push lower-income people into home ownership for which they were not prepared or financially able, and not nearly enough to provide decent living quarters for them. There are a large number of children in this country who are living in inadequate housing that is run by the federal government and in some cases by states as well. To me, there is no greater priority for this committee, so I welcome the Secretary, and we will get right to his testimony. There's no further request for statements. We will begin the testimony with the Secretary. If the ranking member wants 5 minutes at the appropriate time, we'll interrupt the proceeding. And after the Secretary has concluded his testimony, in addition to the five-minute questions, I will certainly recognize any one member on the minority who wanted to make a five-minute statement. On the other hand, I don't have subpoena power. They want to stay away. I can live with that. The Secretary will proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and members of the committee. I want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to testify on the administration's proposed legislation to preserve rental housing for generations to come. I believe the single most important thing we do at HUD is to provide rental assistance to America's most vulnerable families. And I know that you, Mr. Chairman, and so many members of this committee share that view and have worked tirelessly to ensure that we meet that commitment. The current housing crisis has underscored the broad impact HUD has on people's lives. In all, HUD provides deep rental assistance to more than 4.5 million households, helping families and also giving communities the tools they need to tackle their development challenges. As anyone who's ever worked on housing preservation knows, the engine that drives capital investment at the scale needed in a mixed finance environment is a reliable, long-term, market-based stream of federal rental assistance. No other mechanism or no other source of government funding has ever proved as powerful at unlocking a broad range of public and private resources to meet the capital requirements of affordable housing that serves those with the greatest housing needs. HUD's rental assistance programs are absolutely irreplaceable, but it does not take a housing expert to see that they are also in desperate need of simplification and that the status quo is no longer an option. HUD currently administers 13 different rental assistance programs, each with its own rules, managed by 3 operating divisions with separate field staff. This proliferation of programs and delivery systems doesn't make housing more accessible, but less, because families have to fill out dozens of applications processed by scores of administrators simply to have a decent chance of receiving assistance. At the same time, our public housing program alone has a backlog of unmet capital needs estimated at $20 to $30 billion. And in the last 15 years, the absence of a viable preservation strategy has led to the loss of 150,000 units through demolition or sale. But as great as capital needs are, they don't compare to the depth of human need. Countless public housing residents remain in neighborhoods of concentrated poverty because moving means giving up their subsidy. To the Obama administration, failing to preserve these resources for the next generations is simply unacceptable. But just as clear is that we need to do a better job for those generations, and that the federal government can't do it alone. So at this moment, we face a choice. We can approach these challenges piecemeal, or we can try to solve the problem in a comprehensive way. In so doing, we can not only put these programs on firmer ground, but can put an end to the parallel system that exists today, in which most families live in housing that is financed, developed, and managed through mechanisms that can be integrated with the communities around them, while the 2.5 million poor families served by HUD's oldest programs live in another. That is why we have proposed the Preservation, Enhancement, and Transformation of Rental Assistance Act. Mr. Chairman, this legislation not only reflects our best thinking at HUD, but perhaps more importantly, our best listening, incorporating the lessons we've learned from Congress and other stakeholders about what it takes to build strong neighborhoods and help families make the housing choices they need. This legislation would authorize public and assisted housing owners to convert to long-term property-based rental assistance under Section 8 on a voluntary basis. For the sake of brevity, I'll focus on three fundamental principles that guide this legislation. First, that the complexity of our programs is part of the problem. We've seen how smaller legacy programs like Section 8 Mod Rehab, contracts administered by PHAs, and properties assisted under the rent supplement or rental assistance programs have become orphans at HUD as new housing programs have evolved. Along with our FY 2011 budget proposal, this bill will allow us to merge these programs with our core Section 8 program, creating new opportunities for long-term property-based contracts to preserve these units. And by creating a more coherent set of tenant organization and procedural rights and non-discrimination and fair housing requirements, this legislation will ensure that our programs are fairer, easier for families to access, less costly to operate, and more efficiently administered. Second, this bill would change the funding structure of public housing to leverage public and private capital and open public housing to retail, schools, and other community anchors. I want to be completely clear. This bill will not privatize public housing. Neither President Obama nor I have interest in risking such an important resource or opening the door for others to do so. To the contrary, this proposal doesn't change who owns this housing or who is served by it, but rather how this housing is financed. By allowing public housing properties to tap their inherent value to meet their capital needs, like owners of other affordable housing are able to do, this legislation levels the playing field, making it more likely, not less, that properties will remain publicly owned and affordable to the lowest income households. And by maintaining the targeting and affordability requirements of the U.S. Housing Act, the legislation ensures this assistance continues to be targeted to the neediest families. To make sure that leveraging its value does not put this housing in jeopardy, we also have included strong protections in this bill that ensure the long-term affordability and quality. This unprecedented combination of policies will protect tenants and prevent the loss of assisted housing units in the unlikely event of foreclosure. The third principle of this legislation is to encourage resident choice. President Obama and I believe that residents should be able to choose where they live without fear of losing their rental assistance. This isn't a new idea. In the last decade, federal policies like the project-based voucher program have overcome the old division between place-based and people-based assistance by allowing an owner the security and capital leveraging of a long-term property-based contract while assuring that residents can choose to move with available tenant-based vouchers. So, new project-based development already uses this tool. Our legislation ensures that families who live in properties developed under one of our older programs have the opportunity to benefit from a similar policy as well. And so, Mr. Chairman, I hope you can see that the goal of this legislation is to set up a system that meets today's housing needs, preserves these resources for future generations, and ensures they better serve those generations. And by allowing these programs to truly integrate this housing, to bring in a mix of uses and incomes and link this housing to surrounding neighborhoods, I hope you can see that we're committed to ensuring that all families can live in sustainable, vibrant communities of opportunity and choice, wherever they live or whatever their circumstances. That is what this legislation is about. That is what this administration is committed to, and that is what we look forward to realizing with you in the weeks to come. Thank you.
I will now recognize for a five-minute opening statement the ranking member, the gentleman from West Virginia. Then we will go to questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Just briefly, I won't give my entire opening statement, but I would like to thank you again for joining us, Secretary Donovan, and we'll just make a few comments, certainly knowing that making government programs and all of the different rental assistance programs in HUD more efficient is a great goal. But at this time, as we know, in this fiscal year, the President's budget provides for $350 million in funding for phase one, just phase one of this program. And in a time when our nation is facing record deficits, providing this level of funding to fundamentally change federal programs might not be the best plan, especially when project-based assistance has been a more costly way to go in many instances. Further, we have had a back-and-forth discussion in this committee on one-for-one replacement. This legislation calls for one-for-one replacement, meaning that local authorities must replace existing units with the same number of new units, regardless of need. And in areas that have abundant affordable housing units, this may not be the most efficient or appropriate use of our government resources, and that's a debate I'm certain we'll have as we move forward. And I do support the Secretary's goal of making rental assistance programs more efficient. I do have some concerns that the proposal could make the market a bit more confusing. The absence of mandatory compliance could lead to a situation where some programs are replaced while others still exist. And how does this lead to streamlining if we have some areas that are complying and some that are not? And lastly, my favorite part of the day, of this morning, not to disparage the Secretary, is I have a friend who will be testifying on the second panel. I look forward to hearing from my friend Mark Taylor from the Charleston-Kanawha Housing Authority. Mark has been an excellent resource for me as we continue to discuss ways to make our housing programs more efficient. He is a tireless advocate for those seeking affordable housing in Kanawha County, and I'm pleased he's able to join us today and look forward to hearing his thoughts. I want to thank the chairman again for allowing me to give my statement, and I want to thank the secretary for joining us today.
And I appreciate the gentleman doing it very directly. And, Mr. Secretary, you addressed some of the concerns, and that's what we're going to be dealing with. I guess I would separate out two questions. Going to a project-based Section 8 is one thing. The ability to finance and put ownership at risk is another. You say in your opening statement that ownership won't change, but it might if there's a financing and a foreclosure. How necessary is that? Is there some way to try to get financing without that? And if you have a foreclosure, would you then have a, you can have use restrictions, but you then have a private entity? It's almost like contract prisons. Is there then a private entity standing in the shoes of government, and what are the constitutional and other implications of that? So that's what concerns me, is the you anticipate under this you could wind up with a foreclosure and a private ownership of public housing. Are they then required to maintain this public housing in perpetuity? Are they a does a tenant or anyone else have the same constitutional rights vis-a-vis that owner? In the municipalities, for instance, in many municipalities, public housing is a big part of the population. Does that diminish the right of the elected officials who have previously appointed them, or in some cases they're elected? So would you address that? What's the status of a potential private owner of public housing?
Yep. So just to be clear broadly on this subject, this is intended to give, to level the playing field.
Oh, Mr. Secretary, you know we only have 5 minutes. I understand that, but that's not my question. You accept the fact that there may be foreclosures, and I need to know what happens in that case.
Specifically, every other kind of housing today can access not only private financing, but also...
We've had a good working relationship. Don't jeopardize it by not answering the question. That's not what I asked you. You had a chance to talk about that. What happens with a private owner? Yeah, we have public housing that's now publicly owned. What happens? What's the status of a private owner who takes it over?
So there is a required, for any public housing building, there is a required 30-year minimum term with a use agreement initially with renewals of any property-based contract at the unilateral discretion of HUD, and so there is no way for an opt-out to happen
on those
properties.
What's the status? What's the legal?
And
stop, please. What is the legal position you have now? A private owner of what had been public housing. What's the constitutional relationship with the city? What are all those implications?
I'm sorry. I'm trying to answer the question.
No, you're not. Please, answer
The use agreement survives foreclosure,
Okay.
And,
I didn't ask about the opt-out. People have. If you're living in a place owned by a government entity, you have one set of rules. A private entity takes over. What does that do to your constitutional rights, to the relationships with the city? The mayor can't fire you anymore. That's a very important set of questions.
And I thought you were asking about in foreclosure the risk of that happening.
Oh, I
would
very clearly ask, yes. Yes. Then it becomes a private owner.
And so all of those current requirements about the public ownership continue, and the fact that there is private financing does not change that ownership in any way.
But doesn't foreclosure transfer the ownership from the public entity to the private entity?
The foreclosure, first of all of the requirements of affordability continue, and the transfer, any transfer of the property would be subject to the ability of HUD to have a right of first refusal on that transfer.
That's not the question. The question is, if in fact there was a private owner, what's the legal status of that private owner vis-a-vis the tenants, the rest of the city, et cetera? That's pretty clear cut.
In terms of if there is a private owner of that housing, it would still operate under all of the requirements, both for affordability. The housing authority itself would continue to be subject to all of the same appointment of commissioners, other current requirements of public ownership of that land. So, again, if I'm missing the question, if you want to clarify
it. My time has expired. Gentleman from West Virginia.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Certainly, one of the questions that we were discussing this earlier today is the cost, the $350 million of the Phase 1. I mentioned that in my opening remarks. And the proposal proposes to convert rental assistance from to project-based voucher system, which has traditionally been more expensive. So I would wonder, can you address that issue, the added expense of project-based vouchers? But also, it seems to me, anytime you hear the thing streamline, there should be a cost savings. And there's a $290 million of the $350, which is used to convert. If you could address the cost issues with this and the project-based voucher assistance being more expensive and how that is going to play into this.
Yep. Three specific things I would say about that. First of all, the operating costs will increase, but there will be a offsetting savings on the need for capital investment in the properties at the same time. And so because the operating will be used to leverage additional capital to help to renovate the properties, there will not be the same need going forward for direct capital infusions in the property through appropriations. So there
is there a decrease in the capital appropriations ask at HUD?
We are proposing a decrease in the capital appropriations in the budget this year. It is not fully offsetting, but it is a
what's that
there
number,
will be
do you recall?
Excuse me?
What's the number of the capital offset?
The reduction that we're proposing this year is $300 million, I believe. We're just checking on that right now. Second of all, going forward, there would be savings in terms of soft costs because of the complexity of the programs, the need for costs in operating them, as well as any transactions to bring in new capital into the property would be offset as well. Those are not incorporated into the budget for 2011. Mm-hmm. We are working on estimates of what those savings would be going forward. We'd be happy to share those with you, but there are offsetting savings there as well. And then the last thing I would say is there are substantial costs that we're incurring today because public housing is failing in the long term. An ounce of prevention today can avoid substantial long-term costs going forward. We already have a $20 to $30 billion backlog, and I believe strongly that if we don't act now to preserve this resource, the costs in the long term of failing to preserve public housing will be far larger.
Let me ask a question. I was reading through Mr. Taylor's remarks and accepting myself for not understanding every detail of what he was saying, that they are already committed to a capital reinvestment of their projects for 40 years, I think, for the next 40 years. Is that correct? Yeah, 20? 20 years. What consideration in this program would go for one of the housing authorities already made the commitment to improve their properties, and he's done a very nice job. What kind of considerations, and how would that influence what we're seeing here in this bill to the ongoing programs of the housing authorities?
Certainly, if there is investment that is already slated for those properties, they're in good condition, that, I think, would be a benefit in terms of what would be offered by this legislation. It would give housing authorities that are in good condition more flexibility going forward in terms of the sources that they could bring to bear, but also would allow them, because of the operating contracts, more flexibility to use funding for services, to benefit their residents, to incorporate, for example, to bring in retail, to bring in other uses into their properties that could benefit the residents and better integrate them with the neighborhood and help them be sustainable for the long term. So it's not just about the capital that's going into renovations. It's also about bringing in other uses, mixing incomes, a range of other things that could benefit those properties in the long term. So I think there would be opportunities for those housing authorities that are in good condition currently to be able to improve the properties in the very long term.
I see my time's about up. Thank you.
Thank you.
Gentleman from California.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Secretary, for being here today. I'm going to try and continue some of the discussion that was raised by the chairman in relationship to foreclosed properties, and I'm going to go through this exercise because I think it's important for us to engage you on these very, very important issues, but I'm starting out with a negative feeling about TRA. Page 11 of your draft discusses properties in foreclosure or bankruptcy. It is my understanding that your proposal would provide that in the event of a foreclosure or a bankruptcy, that a use restriction would remain on the property. Okay? Use restriction, meaning that this property has to be utilized in the same manner. However, you have language on page 12, lines 1 through 5, stating that the secretary can modify this requirement if the units are not physically viable, financially sustainable, or if necessary, to generate sufficient lender participation. The section goes on to require the secretary to transfer the contract for assistance to other properties if he makes such a finding. And I have a few questions about this. First, why would a property not be physically viable? Isn't it the point of TRA to allow housing authorities to access the private markets so they can rehabilitate their properties? Second, by financially unsustainable, I assume that you mean that the debt on the property exceeds the net operating income needed to make the property run in the black. How would a property get to be in this position in the first place? Also, if the property is in foreclosure, isn't it by definition financially unsustainable? If the housing authority was unable to service the debt because, let's assume, the rents were insufficient, wouldn't the investor have the same problem? Third, it seems that you want to be able to waive the use restriction entirely if you find that it presents an impediment to lenders making loans to housing authorities. Knowing that you could waive the use restriction, it seems to me that lenders would make waiving the restriction a condition of their participation. I think this provision essentially renders the use restriction meaningless. Can you explain under what conditions you would grant such waivers? And fourth, if the use restriction is waived, what happens to the tenants of that property? Do they have to move, or do they receive enhanced vouchers? When the contract is transferred, what kind of property is it transferred to? Is it transferred to a property across town, next door, in the suburbs? On and on and on. I know that I threw a lot of questions at you, but there are hundreds more about this TRA. You want to take a stab at some of those, Mr. Secretary?
Happy to do that. First of all, we currently have any new affordable housing that's developed is developed in this way. So we have long experience in how to protect properties in foreclosure from losing that housing. TRA would actually enhance our ability to do that in a number of ways. First of all, there would be a required use agreement that would survive the foreclosure, as you said. In addition to that, however, we also would have a right of first refusal in order to ensure that if the current housing authority, the owner, is not able to keep up that property, if we don't believe they have the capacity to do that, that we could direct the property to a different public owner or to an owner that we're sure is going to be able to preserve it. So that's a very important tool to be able to ensure that the property is preserved in the long term. The specific provision that you asked about transferring assistance, the truth is that we do have properties that are currently under severe distress that we will not be able to preserve even today. We've already, as I said in my testimony, lost about 150,000 units of public housing because of the inability to preserve them.
Mr. Secretary, my time is just about up, and I will talk with you some more about this, but I just want you to know that this experiment I consider very dangerous. And I'm, as I've said over and over again, I'm not about to be a part of privatizing public housing. I think that there are a lot of problems with this experiment, and I would like you to just really think about some of the questions that you're going to hear today. And if you're still interested in pursuing it, map out a time over the next 2 years where you can meet with residents, you can talk with advocates, you can have more hearings, you can flush all of this out rather than trying to move with something this tremendous, this big. Thank you. I yield back the balance of my time.
Texas.
Mr. Secretary, I'd like to follow up a little bit on the chairman's previous question. If the lender, even through foreclosure, is bound by a previous set of circumstances and has a very limited amount of discretion in what the lender can do with the property once the foreclosure takes place, doesn't that significantly reduce the number of potential buyers for the property, and doesn't it potentially restrict the pool, the borrowing, to where the lenders, with the prospect of not having the freedom once they get the property back to dispose of it in the way they normally would, won't that limit the borrowers, or am I misunderstanding?
I think it's very important that we are clear with any lenders or any other investors in the property. There would be tax credit equity that would come into these properties. We have long experience now with affordable housing, and lenders do as well, with those types of restrictions. So to be very clear, I think it is there is a large market for lending on these properties that's developed already. And lenders are well understand the restrictions as they go into these deals, and there are a pool of buyers that would be available, but they will be required to preserve this housing as affordable going forward should we get to that foreclosure situation. So would it restrict the buyers somewhat? Yes, but that's a restriction that we believe is important to ensure that the property continues as affordable housing, and there is a broad market for lending for these types of properties already that could be tapped given those restrictions.
Well, in most of the syndicated programs that I've seen, most of the tax benefits are stripped out of the units in the early years, and the tax credits are separated away from the unit, and then usually there are investors that take the benefits of those tax credits, so that when you get into the mid to later stages of the financing, the repayment, and you get the property back, would you then propose that when it was resold by the lender that the tax credits would be reconstituted?
There are a number of ways to handle a situation like that where it's late in the compliance periods. Typically, states are requiring at least 30 years, but typically much longer use restrictions already. And so we see those situations come up where those properties can be recapitalized. Sometimes new tax credits may be necessary for the next generation of repairs to the property, but in many cases, other types of financing debt or other forms of assistance, whether it be home or CDBG funding from HUD or other sources are available. So that is one option that you described, but it's not the only option available. And again, this is something that we see happening with all new affordable housing that's developed through the low-income housing tax credit already.
And my second question, if this program is mandatory and you have a significant number of people that choose not to convert, you will then be required to continue to operate two separate programs. And so whatever consolidation savings you thought you were going to get, are you going to really be able to realize them with two, with having to operate now instead of one program, another program?
We believe that there will be significant savings even from the first year in terms of, I talked earlier about many of our orphan programs that are quite small programs today that don't have any option for preservation today. We believe there will be very strong participation, even on a voluntary basis, that will allow us to streamline a number of the programs very quickly. In the longer run, we believe that we need to demonstrate the effectiveness of this conversion process. We're proposing a first year, and that we should come back to Congress to discuss whether other properties in future years would be required to convert, rather than making a decision today on that. But in the long run, we believe there is the potential, if we get this right, to bring all the programs together and achieve the full benefits of that consolidation. We believe there will be the benefits in the early years, but the full benefits would come in later years with further legislation from Congress.
Thank you.
The gentlewoman from New York.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, this TRA is quite an ambitious proposal, and if adopted, it will transform the way housing assistance is provided in the United States. As proposed, it gives you flexibility to include additional rental programs. Can you explain to us what will be the process for adding those? And are you planning to include additional housing programs like HOPWA? If this is an open-ended flexibility?
Our initial focus will be on public housing, but also on assisted housing that is funded through rent supplement and the rental assistance program and the Section 8 moderate rehabilitation. The other piece I would mention is that there are about 40,000 units of assisted housing that are owned by public housing agencies that now operate under different rules.
So it will give you the authority. That's what I want to know.
So we do not propose, whether it's HOPWA or any of the other programs.
No, but it says here, and this is the legislative language, other federal affordable housing programs as identified by the Secretary by notice.
We do believe that if this is successful, we will see interest from housing authorities in converting some of their other programs. HOPWA is not, at this point, one of those programs that we are interested in.
As you know, hundreds of thousands of New Yorkers are on the waiting list for public housing and Section 8. And in your testimony, you suggest that in certain cases, waiting lists may be affected as a result of TRA. In what instances will that take place?
Sorry, Congressman, just to be very clear, HOPWA actually is not one of those programs that even legislatively would be allowed under the current legislation. So it's not included in one of those programs. We could give you more detail on which programs would be possible, but HOPWA is not one of them.
I'm just reading you your language. It says here, other federal affordable housing programs as identified by the Secretary by notice. So it's open-ended. You could include HOPWA if you deem
I think the place that the language would modify in the statute does not include HOPWA, and so it is a limited number of programs. We could get you specifics of which exactly would be allowed by that.
So but in what instances will that take place? Your testimony suggests that in certain cases, waiting lists may be affected.
Yes. So currently, there is the ability for project-based voucher recipients to move to the front of the line for waiting lists.
Okay, so my next question is, you answer my question, how is HUD balancing the needs of applicants currently on waiting lists with tenants who may be newly eligible under TRA for Section 8 assistance? Will that happen at the expense of people in the waiting list, Section 8?
It's a very good question. We've had a lot of comments and input about this from stakeholders that we've met with. What we would do in order to ensure fairness for those on the waiting list is have a minimum two-year residency within the development before you could get access to a voucher, and a requirement that no more than one-third of vouchers that are freed up would have to go to residents who want to exercise that mobility right. So that, we believe, would institute a fair process to ensure those on the waiting list already would have access to vouchers.
One out of three, right?
One out of three.
Mm-hmm.
But again, we believe that the current limitation that for a resident of public housing, the only way that they can continue to receive assistance is to remain in their unit, that if they want to move to take a job or because their family is moving or a relative is sick, they have no ability to keep their assistance. So we do believe that this is an important benefit to residents of public housing and other forms of assisted housing for them.
But it will be at the expense of those who have been for so long in a waiting list for Section 8.
I believe we've balanced that. I would also say that it would free up units within public housing. The unit that they were leaving would continue to be project-based and would be open then to somebody off the waiting list there. So there is continues to be housing opportunities available for those on waiting lists.
Thank you.
The gentleman from North Carolina.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, thank you for being here. I don't want to belabor the point that the chair and several other members have made, but I do have some concerns about your ability to bind folks after there's a foreclosure or a bankruptcy. And I also have a concern about the flexibility that would be given to the secretary to waive the requirements. I'm reading the summary of the bill, and it says, like the protect, this clause provides that the terms of new rental assistance contracts or use agreements remain in effect in the event of foreclosure or bankruptcy. That's fine. But the secretary would be authorized to modify this requirement if the units were not viable or, quote, if necessary to generate sufficient lender participation. So you've got two concerns that are raised here. One is the legal situation that's created and your ability to bind somebody, both a lender and who is making a loan and a purchaser who is buying in at a foreclosure, which is questionable. The other side of that is the amount of discretion that's given to secretaries of HUD to waive those requirements under certain circumstances. I want to say publicly that I have eminently great confidence in you making and this administration making those decisions. But I tell you, I wouldn't have had a hill of beans worth of confidence in the last Secretary of HUD in the last administration making those same decisions. So I think that would be a real concern to me. I'm not going to beat that horse anymore. Several people have elaborated on that. A concern that I have expressed about this proposal and about the choice proposal is, and I've had this discussion in my office with several people from your department, I actually, it's a great way to generate more capital to be more entrepreneurial, but I'm not sure that that you all appreciate the variation in the entrepreneurial ability of housing authorities around the country out there. There's a great deal of variation of entrepreneurial expertise in these housing authorities, and I see it in the variation in the housing authorities in my own congressional district. Some of them are very business savvy. Others are very good at administering public housing and keeping it up and collecting the rent and, you know, doing what HUD requires them to do. But I don't see any level of entrepreneurial expertise out there. So there's this variation that takes place. Unless you're going to put in place some kind of very strong support system, which coincidentally hadn't necessarily been in place from HUD administration to HUD administration either. There's not the confidence, again, I don't want to beat the last administration's HUD secretary to death. He's a good friend of mine personally, but we never could get any answers out of him for this committee when we would ask him anything. And I'm not sure I would want him to be putting in place the support mechanisms for housing authorities that vary. So if you can comment on that quickly, my time is about to run out, and I've taken too much of it asking the question.
Three specific things I would say. First of all, that for those housing authorities, particularly smaller housing authorities, we already impose on them what I would say are too complex and burdensome rules and requirements for their operation. We frankly treat them kind of one size fits all, like they were larger housing authorities. And one of the things that moving to TRA would allow us to do, I believe, is simplify the requirements for particularly those smaller housing authorities or housing authorities with less capacity that would actually make it easier for them to operate rather than harder, first. Second, we see with property-based contracts many, many small nonprofits or other small for-profits that are able to work successfully with us under the kind of proposal that we're putting forward. And I believe we'd be happy to spend more time with you to give you some of the specifics of the way those benefits would flow to them, that we could effectively operate with them with the support that they would need. The third thing I would say is we've had a lot of discussion with FHA about the ability to offer debt for those properties where there might be some initial difficulties in figuring out how to access capital, along with other forms of technical assistance. So I do believe through FHA and through other forms of technical assistance, we could help those housing authorities.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, I held an oversight subcommittee hearing a few weeks ago on the issue of debt and leverage and how we need to reverse our overdependence on both. If there's one thing I hope we've learned from the recent financial crisis, it's that we need to get back to living within our means like our parents and grandparents did and learned to do after the Great Depression. Part of that lesson, I think, must include the understanding that not everyone can be a homeowner, and that's okay as long as there's affordable housing available. In that spirit, how will this transforming rental assistance initiative meet the objective to provide affordable housing options for individuals and families who are not homeowners?
This would do that by ensuring that these precious resources, public housing and other affordable housing that we provide, is preserved for the next generation who can't be homeowners. The fact that we have a $20 to $30 billion backlog of unmet capital needs in this housing, that this particularly public housing today has no ability to access low-income housing tax credits or other sources of capital that every other form of affordable housing in the country has ability to access. I believe that if we stay on the path that we're on, the status quo, we will continue to lose critical rental resources year after year because we don't have the capital available to them to be able to keep that housing up. So I think this is a very important step in preserving that rental housing for those who can't become homeowners.
Thank you. Does the administration's proposal include oversight enhancements or fraud mitigation provisions to ensure that taxpayer dollars are used efficiently and properly? If so, would you describe those? And if not, what could they be added to the proposal to ensure we fully expose and minimize waste, fraud, and abuse?
We do have provisions to ensure strong oversight of the properties. If there are others that you would be interested in discussing with us, we'd be happy to talk about them. What I would say is it does give us, the legislation, the ability to pursue civil money penalties that are enhanced for violations of provisions under the contracts or the requirements of the use agreements.
Okay. And has HUD performed any cost-benefit analysis on this proposal to see if taxpayer dollars would be used more effectively compared to current programs? And if not, would your department be able to do a cost-benefit analysis and provide that in writing to members of this committee?
We'd be happy to do that. We have begun that analysis. We've looked, obviously, at the 2011 costs and benefits of it, but we're analyzing the longer-term costs and benefits today, and we'll be happy to provide that to the committee.
Thank you very much. Mr. Chairman, yield back my time.
The gentleman from Missouri.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Secretary, especially for your visit yesterday to my hometown, St. Louis, Missouri, and your tour of the Northside Regeneration Project. Hopefully, we can establish a strong working relationship to see that project through. Let me start off by asking you, can you give us examples of the use of the $4 billion in ARRA funding that went to capital improvements of public housing units? Like, can you point out what that money was used for by those local housing authorities, and do you think it was an effective use of the funds?
I do believe that the ARRA funds have been very effective, that they've gotten out quickly. And to date, we already have about 180,000 units of public housing that have completed renovations thanks to the ARRA funds. A lot of that is longstanding work, basic work of replacing roofs, providing better, whether it's plumbing fixtures or kitchens or other basic amenities in those apartments. They've also been used very effectively, and St. Louis is a good example, to introduce energy efficiency into public housing. Solar is a particular focus that the St. Louis Housing Authority is pursuing with their competitive funds from ARRA. And what's important about those is that they both improve the living conditions for residents, they lower the cost for residents, but they also lower the cost to the taxpayer. Typically, those investments are paying back the initial investment in 3 to 5 years.
And I guess certain units get to the point where you have to make a decision of whether we demolish those units or we try to make improvements to it. I mean, how do you see that?
Well, look, this is the fundamental challenge that we're trying to address with this bill is despite being able to get $4 billion of desperately needed capital in the Recovery Act, there continues to be $20 to $30 billion of capital needs in public housing alone. And given the current fiscal challenges that we have, I just don't think there's a way that we're going to get to that full capital need through direct appropriations. And so what we're trying to do with this bill is to ensure that we make those investments today so that we can avoid, at the point that the roof actually caves in and the property can no longer be saved, or that it can only be saved at a far higher cost, much better to prevent that from happening today with investments in keeping up those properties than to have to suffer the loss of housing and the much higher costs of saving those properties down the line. We believe the time to invest in these properties is now, and that's really what TRA is trying to achieve.
In an ideal world, how do you envision streamlining some of HUD's housing programs?
Well, first of all, we don't see a need to have so many of them. We have 13 deep rental assistance programs today. Many of them really operate like orphans. They're earlier programs that are no longer actively used for new housing, but whether it's the alphabet soup of Rents Up and RAP and Mod Rehab, all of those programs today continue, and we have a very hard time preserving those properties for future generations. By being able to simplify our programs, bring those into our Section 8 umbrella, we could both preserve them, continue to have good housing going forward, while at the same time not having so many different rules and regulations for the different housing that we operate, and making it simpler for tenants to be able to understand the rules, not have to fill out as many different applications with different rules that they currently have to do in order to get access to decent housing.
Sounds like it's something we need to modernize public housing and assistance in this country. Mr. Chairman, I yield back. Thank you.
The gentleman from New York.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Secretary. Listening to the questions and answers, I guess I'll follow through with that, because I still think there's a little bit of concern on the consolidation. My concern in two fronts would be on how are we going to work with the, how do you envision a consolidation taking place that doesn't interrupt the current services to the various sectors of people served, for example, the disabled and the elderly. And just out of curiosity, between the public housing and the private housing with Section 8, and you might not have this answer at this time, and I'll take it down the road, but on safety issues for the residents, I can speak for some of the public housing and the private housing on Long Island. Safety issues are a big concern. People are afraid to go out of their apartments in the evening time, and that's in a suburban area. Certainly reading the papers and looking at some of the things that happen in public housing. How do we make the public housing safer for those residents that are in there?
Well, I think you ask a really important question, particularly about the elderly and the disabled, because we have almost 1.5 million households that are either elderly or disabled or both living in units that would be covered by TRA. And one of the fundamental barriers to making them safe for the residents that you're talking about, whether it's accessibility and being able to continue to live in those units with the kind of features that are necessary, as well as just overall safety in terms of protection for the residents, whether it's installing security measures or having funding for resident programs and other things that enhance safety. All of that is hurt by the lack of capital to be able to keep these properties up. And so that $20 to $30 billion capital gap that I talked about is a fundamental barrier to making public housing more safe and accessible to elderly and disabled families. What we're proposing is a way to be able to bring that capital, $25 billion in total is our estimate that we could access, to be able to improve public housing for access to those residents and their safety.
Because one of the concerns I have is that been into some public housing, especially for the elderly and the disabled, what some people would consider that it's been fitted for a disabled person or an elderly person. I hope that you have better architects out there. A handrail here and a handrail there doesn't cut it. You know, we're talking about, you know, whether it's a sit-in shower, whether it's an open tub. I know those things are expensive, but those are the qualities of life to give so that we can keep them out of nursing homes, to be very honest with you. comes down to a point, if they can't take care of themselves or with an aide, they're going to end up in a nursing home, which is going to cost a lot more money. And, of course, down the road, I guess we're going to see some disagreement on allowing guns into public housing, something I'll try to fight, and hopefully I can work with you on language that we can work on that together so those undesirables in public housing don't have guns to threaten the residents that are actually just trying to have some sort of peace of life.
I would just recommend to you, I saw a remarkable example in your colleague's district yesterday of a universally designed, fully accessible development there with a mix of incomes, disabled, non-disabled, and really a remarkable example, I think, of the work that can be done to make housing more accessible.
Thank you.
The gentleman from California.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you very much, Secretary, for being here. Reading your statement, and I just want to quote on what you stated here on page 2, you said HUD currently administers 13 different rental programs, each with its own rules, managed by three operative divisions with separate field staff. What do you propose in streamlining this process and making it more effective in providing assistance?
Our initial proposal under the 2011 budget and the legislation, supported by the legislation that we've proposed, would focus on four of those programs primarily, public housing, as well as three others, the rental assistance program, rent supplement program, and Section 8 mod rehabilitation. Those are particularly smaller programs that don't have preservation options that we believe need to be given those options and could be consolidated into Section 8. Public housing is the other main focus, and there the biggest issue really is the access to capital that I've talked about earlier. In terms of the streamlining that would exist, what it would allow us to do is just, for example, not have different rules in terms of incomes for those who could be admitted to the property, the way that those calculations are done, different rules if you want to be able to refinance those properties.
Be separate rules? Because right now you're complaining and saying that everyone operates on their own and are managed by different set of rules. These would be the same set of rules that would be applied to these
exactly.
The
goal would be to harmonize and standardize those rules on income and a range of other criteria.
Okay. In doing so, I'm also very concerned that as you move in that direction, that diversity will also be there in terms of the hiring of individuals that would implement these kind of programs, and hopefully you'll take that into consideration as well.
Absolutely. And, in fact, the legislation specifies that what we call Section 3, those are the requirements for hiring residents, both of public housing and the local communities. Those would continue for housing authorities moving forward under the legislation.
Then on page 3, you said, given the size of the federal deficit and the challenge we inherited, it is clear that the federal government alone will not be able to provide funds needed to bring properties up to date and preserve them for the next generation. How do we achieve this? And how do we become more cost-effective in providing public housing?
The major barrier for public housing today is that, unlike every other kind of affordable housing, they're unable, except with extreme efforts that are very, very difficult, to access low-income housing tax credits, loans from any other source. And so the fundamental way that we would be able to preserve particularly public housing through this proposal is to open up the ability to get access to funding and other support, both from other public sector sources and private sector sources. But the other thing that I think is critical that I don't want to lose focus on as well, today it's almost impossible for the typical public housing development to bring in retail development or bring in other types of uses and services because of the way it's financed and structured in terms of the ownership of the land. And so providing more flexibility to bring in those other uses, we believe is an equally important part of the long-term preservation. It will allow public housing to be integrated with the communities around it with other types of uses rather than just the single use of residential that has been effectively required of public housing in the past.
Would that help in reference to what was said earlier with the Section 8? There are many people on a waiting list that it takes almost 2 years, and the problem is that people are without jobs, without housing, and yet need to get into affordable housing, yet there's a waiting list, you know, that's there that could go up to 2 years. Would this expedite that process, or what would be done to reduce that, because people are in need right now to get into these housing?
Well, one of the reasons that we have more people on the waiting list than we would like is that we have many public housing apartments that don't have funding to be renovated and made available for rental. We've lost about 150,000 units of public housing over the last decade or so.
Why have we lost that?
Because there hasn't been the capital available to keep them in good condition, and this TRA would allow us to access that capital.
The gentleman from Georgia.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Welcome, Secretary Donovan. Secretary Donovan, one of the most heartbreaking situations that our homeowners are facing now is the fact that since we've been in this real depression, we've lost about $9 trillion in home values. I wanted to, first of all, before I get into some questions on the tenant rental assistance, what are your thoughts about that? Why are we dealing with this? What is available to the homeowner who may be watching this this hearing as to what they can do to restore the values of their homes? What is the administration doing to address this terrible issue of the loss of home values at the tune of $9 trillion? What are we doing to recapture that?
There is no single answer to what we can do. What it has required over the last year is a broad range of efforts that go to stabilizing the economy and the job picture more broadly. Obviously, the Recovery Act was critical to that. And then more specifically, keeping interest rates low, encouraging refinancing, modifying the mortgages of over 1.2 million families to date across the country, and providing more free refinancing options, particularly for underwater borrowers. FHA has been a very effective tool for doing that, and we are expanding this summer even further the options for underwater borrowers to refinance. All of that has led to the housing market stabilizing and beginning to turn around. Since April of last year, we've added $1 trillion in equity for homeowners in this country. You compare that to the $9 trillion that you talked about, 30 straight months of declines in housing values when we came into office. We're not out of the woods by any means. We've still got a ways to go, but we've been able to stabilize that and begin to help homeowners build equity again, a total of $1 trillion, according to the Federal Reserve.
But does a homeowner have anything at his disposal? He gets in the mail this form that says that his home has lost this much in value, and they want to maybe appeal that. Is there anything moving where they have some access to address that and appeal that amount?
The most direct way that we can help underwater homeowners is through refinancing of those properties and getting a write-down of their existing loan to a level that's sustainable. That's what our FHA program is intended to do. What I would suggest to homeowners is that they reach out to a HUD-approved housing counselor in their community. You can find that on our HUD website. We have counselors available in every community, and they can help with the specific needs of a homeowner to be able to connect them to options.
In Georgia, I represent counties like Clayton County and Cobb County and Douglas County, all around Atlanta. We've had one of the highest foreclosure rates in abandoned homes. What is the relationship that HUD has to the Neighborhood Stabilization Act, and how would you rate that in terms of impacting on the issue of continuing to raise that value, and how successful has that been?
We believe the Neighborhood Stabilization Program has been very successful to date. About 17,000 homes have been completed, and we believe with the $6 billion that has been allocated in total that we should reach a total of about 80,000 homes. And in fact, I was in the Philadelphia neighborhood in your area, near your district, just on Friday, and witnessed an entire street that has been stabilized thanks to the investments of neighborhood stabilization. And we believe that actually we ought to invest more money in neighborhood stabilization. We announced last week support, administration support for doing that.
All right, before the chairman brings his hammer down, this question on the TRA. In units converted under TRA, residents would have the right to move out of their homes and maintain rental assistance with a housing choice voucher. How many people in the converted units are expected to use their mobility rights under this initiative?
Currently, what we see is that about 11% of residents move out each year. And with the 300,000 units that we proposed for TRA in the first year, we believe that we could certainly balance vouchers through turnover, natural turnover in the voucher program for those folks who want to move out without disadvantaging those who are in the waiting list or having any risk to those properties that are in the program.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
Thank you. I can't resist noting that the Neighborhood Stabilization Program was written here with the gentleman from California in the lead, and it was the product of this committee under her leadership, and we appreciate the seriousness with which it has been taken. The gentleman from Indiana.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, as you are intimately aware, our most vulnerable families are facing an unprecedented crisis today. TRA will give low-income families greater flexibility to rent housing in a wide range of neighborhoods. I'm interested in understanding how HUD will determine which voucher holders are ready to move into better neighborhoods. I also want to ensure that this plan will not conflict with the overall goal of improving existing rental housing. And secondly, generally speaking, I'd like to also understand, sir, what HUD is doing to ensure rental units meet minimum standards of health and safety.
So, first of all, what I would say is I think the most important thing that TRA would achieve is to ensure that we do preserve existing housing for future generations. Quite simply, a capital backlog of $20 to $30 billion is not will not allow these properties to serve future generations. We are at risk of losing tens of thousands more units of public housing if we don't act quickly to try to bring resources to the table to preserve that housing. So that is really the primary goal of TRA, is the preservation of public housing and other assisted housing. So I think that's key. Second of all, what I would say is we do believe that with the feature of choice that we're proposing to add, that it's a critical thing and an important statement to say low-income people should have opportunities to move without the risk, the fear of losing their rental assistance. And today, we provide that in project-based vouchers, but we don't provide it in the large majority of our programs. But we do recognize that it isn't just enough to say there's a voucher. TRA, we are actually proposing to provide some of the first-year funding towards counseling and other forms of assistance that would help families using vouchers to access neighborhoods of opportunity. And those have been shown to be successful in many places around the country, and we want to support that kind of assistance to ensure that families have a real choice, not just a theoretical choice about where they live.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Mr. Chairman, I yield back my time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Donnelly.
No questions, Madam Chairwoman.
If there are no more questions, the chair notes that some members may have additional questions for the secretary, which they may wish to submit in writing. Without objection, the hearing record will remain open for 30 days for members to submit written questions to the secretary and to place their responses in the record. We'd like to thank you, Mr. Secretary, for being here today Your testimony has been very, very helpful to us. And with that, we will call on our second panel. Thank you. Without objection, we have over 1,000 petitions that have been signed by individuals concerned about TRA. Without objection, I'd like to submit them for the record. I'm pleased to welcome our distinguished second panel. Our first witness will be Mr. Thomas Gleason, Executive Director, Mass Housing, on behalf of the National Council of State Housing Agencies. Our second witness will be Mr. Paul T. Graziano, Executive Director and Housing Commissioner, Housing Authority of Baltimore City, on behalf of the Council of Large Public Housing Authorities. Our third witness will be Ms. Terry Preston Koenig, President, National Leased Housing Association. Our fourth witness will be Ms. Betsy Martins, Senior Vice President, National Association of Housing and Redevelopment Officials. Our fifth witness will be Ms. Judy Martinez, Board Member, National Alliance of HUD Tenants. Our sixth witness will be Ms. Damaris Reyes, Executive Director, good old Lori Eastside, on behalf of National People's Action. Our seventh witness will be Mr. John Ray, Chairman, New York City Housing Authority. Our final witness will be Mr. Mark Taylor, Executive Director, Charleston, Kanahau Housing Authority, Charleston, West Virginia. Without objection, your written statement will be made a part of the record. And I will now begin with our first witness to be recognized for 5 minutes. Mr. Gleason. Thank you very much.
Align the courtrooms within the building, whether there will be an atrium, for what purposes they are. And so at the end of the process, we have built a building, and we have focused very much on our overall dollar authorizations.
I'm sorry, you cannot be heard up here. Is your microphone on?
I can tell you in the
microphone. Okay, thank you.
Technology eludes me, Madam Chair.
All right, thank you.
I am testifying today on behalf of the National Council of State Housing Agencies. NCSHA supports HUD key goals for the TRA initiative, namely preservation, simplification, and mobility. While we are still analyzing this proposal, we want to raise 5 preliminary concerns for the committee. First, we believe that the property recapitalization demands that the TRA initiative will place on the housing credit and other federal housing resources have not been adequately assessed. These programs are already oversubscribed in many states, and the TRA initiative will only cause further strain on these limited resources. We ask that you work with the leadership of the Ways and Means Committee to ensure that additional credit is provided to states to meet this increased demand. Otherwise, states will have to make difficult choices between preserving TRA developments, producing new rental housing, or preserving existing privately financed affordable housing developments. Second, we're pleased that the latest TRA proposal provides for project-based Section 8 for most of the developments that undergo conversion. Years of experience have shown us that project-based Section 8 is the best tool available for ensuring long-term affordability and attracting private capital. We believe that HUD's proposal provides the Secretary with the discretion allowed for converted TRA developments to utilize market rents and in some cases, budget-based rents that exceed market rents, where necessary to support appropriate rehabilitation and higher operating costs. This rent-setting flexibility is critical to ensure successful TRA conversions in high-cost but low-rent areas. In fact, we believe the Chairman's Preservation Bill is a better vehicle to accomplish this, and for several existing project-based rental assistance programs. It will provide not only more options, but increase certainty in how particular projects will be financed. Third, NCSHA strongly supports mobility as a means for creating opportunity for residents to improve the quality of their life. However, it must be achieved without reducing the resources available to help other families. It is troubling that residents of converted TRA developments will be able to have a priority over many needy, unassisted individuals and families who have been waiting for voucher assistance for years. We believe that this cannot be treated as a zero-sum game. In order to accommodate the TRA mobility feature without impacting on existing waiting lists, additional rental vouchers are needed. Furthermore, tenant mobility will have the unintended consequence of creating higher vacancies at these developments, leading to lower operating income, which will in turn reduce the amount of debt that can be leveraged in the future for property rehabilitation. Fourth, NCSHA is pleased that HUD's TRA proposal relies exclusively on voluntary participation by PHAs and private owners. We urge the committee not to make participation mandatory. We also urge the committee to limit HUD's authority to expand the TRA program to additional programs too quickly. We recommend that the committee fully review the outcomes of the TRA initiative before allowing HUD to extend the program simply by notice. One way to do this would be by authorizing this effort as a pilot program only. Fifth and finally, HUD needs to define the kinds of entities it will seek to administer rental assistance contracts on TRA properties and to elaborate on the scope of their expected activities. Many HFAs would be interested in expanding their responsibilities to include TRA properties. This would be especially true for those, like Mass Housing, that have successfully participated for more than a decade in HUD's Section 8 project-based contract administration program. However, we're concerned that the opportunity for HUD to take advantage of HFA experience and capacity may be lost if HUD stays on its current course toward rebidding PBCA contracts without recognizing the unique strengths that HFAs bring to their role as contract administrator. Thank you, Madam Chair, and members of this committee for the opportunity to testify, and please let me know if NCSHA can provide any further information to help you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Graziano. Is your mic on?
I'm sorry. My name is Paul Graziano. I'm the Executive Director of the Housing Authority of Baltimore City, Housing Commissioner for the City of Baltimore, and a board member of the Council of Large Public Housing Authorities. I'm pleased to be here representing CLAFA for today's hearing on the PETRA legislation. CLAFA has been actively engaged in discussions with public housing stakeholders to develop a preservation strategy through reform of the funding and regulatory system. Such reform was a primary focus of the summit on the future of public housing convened by CLAFA in 2008 and the policy framework produced by the summit participants. The criteria for preservation is straightforward. As the summit framework called for, we seek a long-term funding structure that addresses reasonable operating costs, adequate replacement reserves, and recapitalizes the portfolio by converting public housing to more adequate, reliable, and flexible subsidy models. We commend Secretary Donovan for his vision and commitment to preserve and expand affordable housing. To hear the Secretary say that public housing is an irreplaceable public asset that must be preserved represents a turning point in this most important public policy debate. We are dedicated to the mission to serve the needs of low-income people. We do not want to put the properties or the people we serve at risk. There are many competing demands in determining how to reform and transform affordable housing programs, including HUD's own internal administration, streamlining objectives, and other social policy mandates. But for us, the most immediate and compelling objective is the preservation and improvement of public housing stock. We are very concerned that this urgent goal may be lost in the maelstrom of transformation for the department and other housing programs. PETRA creates an overly complex approach to preservation with a complicated financial and rent-setting framework, sweeping and untested social policy mandates and burdensome administrative and regulatory requirements, some of which undermine the very goal of preservation. More to the point, we favor a slimmed-down bill that focuses on preservation, not on transforming HUD. In general, the bill tries to do too much too soon with too little resources. Rental assistance conversion should be the core focus, purpose, and entirety of the bill. Our concerns with the authority to convert are centered around the options and opportunities for PHAs to use more reliable subsidy models to leverage private capital and, in particular, the restrictions on the use of project-based vouchers as a viable conversion option. Project-based vouchers have significant market acceptance as an effective redevelopment tool for PHAs and their private partners. Converting public housing to PBV program is simply a way to address the capital backlog once and for all over the next several years, thereby establishing more sustainable and administratively efficient program for the future. We are particularly heartened by the financial leveraging tools embodied in the proposed in other proposed legislation, which would pledge the full faith and credit of the United States in the public housing loan guarantee and also authorizes housing tax credit exchange for rehabilitation of qualified public housing units. These tools are integral and critical elements to ensure the success of public housing preservation strategy. At the core of the effective preservation strategy, there must be a rent-setting policy that ensures long-term affordability. HUD estimates 300,000 units can be preserved through PETRA. We've done a study in CLAFA, and we believe that the $290 million will actually preserve approximately 60 to 65,000 units, funding at an average level of approximately $80,000 per unit from rehab. Furthermore, according to our estimates, about 58% of the national portfolio would be able to raise sufficient debt using FMRs to preserve the properties and cash flow. The remaining 42% of the properties would need exceptions above the FMR to cover this cost. I have attached to our testimony, in the written testimony, a couple of appendices. Appendix B, I'll just refer to very briefly, shows a range of developments in the city of Baltimore. You'll see that the rents vary by neighborhood. And so that's a real issue. The level of rehab is the same, but the rents are comparable rents are lower, so we need to address that issue. Resident choice and mobility, we're very concerned about the impact here on our waiting list and whether it's an equitable decision. In closing, I would just like to say that we think the program needs to focus on those core principles of public housing preservation. We applaud HUD, and we thank the committee for the opportunity to speak today.
Thank you. Our next witness will be Ms. Terry Preston Koenig.
Thank you. My name is Terry Preston Koenig. I'm a principal and director of community development and affordable housing services for Baker Tilly Virchow Krauss, a CPA and consulting services firm. I'm here presenting National Leased Housing Association as the incoming president. I'm very happy to be able to present testimony today. Madam Chairman and members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to testify on the administration's proposal to radically overhaul our assisted housing programs. This is far-reaching and complex legislation. It can impact the viability and preservation of 2.6 million units in HUD-assisted projects, affect the tenant-based voucher program that assists 2.2 million poor households, and adversely impact millions of poor persons who may be in dire circumstances because they do not have affordable housing and are seeking to obtain federal housing assistance that is indeed in limited supply. We have the utmost respect for Secretary Donovan, but we believe the transformation initiative to be ill-conceived and unrealistic. HUD seeks to justify its sweeping proposal by asserting that it has too many separate rental housing programs. It designates 13 within its own rules, and that these should be consolidated into fewer programs. Among the 13 programs that HUD has actually identified that should be eliminated include programs such as Housing for Opportunities for People with AIDS, Shelter Plus Care for Homeless Persons, Section 202 Assistance for Elderly Persons, and Section 811 Assistance for Disabled Persons. These programs serve people with distinctive needs. We're unsure what consolidation will do for the nonprofit sponsors, or more importantly, for those people that they serve. Also included in this list of 13 is a Section 8 project-based program. This program assists families in about 1.4 million units. This program is an extremely valuable long-term resource for providing affordable rents for poor families and is functioning well. It is beyond our understanding why HUD would propose to convert an established program into a new program with new rules. HUD says, don't worry, conversion to the program would be voluntary. No owner would be required to convert. But if some owners convert and others do not, how can streamlining occur if two programs replace one? Any perceived streamlining could only be achieved if HUD does induce conversion. Indeed, Secretary Donovan noted in his testimony that full benefits could only be achieved if all programs converted. If this proposal is enacted, it could immediately destabilize the preservation of the Section 8 project-based inventory. The reason lenders and investors put their funds into preservation at Section 8 projects is based because they have confidence in the predictability and stability of the Section 8 project-based rules. Why should a lender make a long-term loan on good terms to a property with current project-based Section 8 HAP contract when there is a chance that this project could be converted to another program with more restricted rents and more undesirable rules? And why should a Section 8 owner renew its contract if HUD makes it disadvantageous to remain under the Section 8 program, even if the owner chooses not to convert? We urge the committee to reduce the scope of this proposal to areas of recognized need where some good might be accomplished. This program aimed at preserving public housing could actually aid an additional tool. We believe that instead of promoting a large-scale transformation, that we should look at requesting a pilot program to preserve the public housing. This would aid programs such as public housing to look towards residents, investors, and communities and develop a workable framework that might support preservation. When you look at rents up and wrap conversions, this is an area where rental subsidy contracts could actually be helped. However, there's no need to create a new program to preserve these units. We've attached language which could accomplish the objective. The same holds true for Section 8 mod rehab program. A pending provision in the preservation bill before this committee could provide adequate solutions to the preservation of the 27,000 units that are outstanding on the moderate rehabilitation programs. Finally, regarding mobility, this is simply not great policy. Resident choice doesn't mean that residents can wait to turn for a voucher. This means that they can jump to the top of a voucher list. If one out of the next three vouchers is available, it becomes inequitable and unsound housing policy. Extending the time for a poor person has been waiting on this list from 2 to 3 years, or roughly a 50% extension of the people who have been waiting and waiting to get housing. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next witness will be Ms. Bessie Martins.
Chairwoman Waters, members of the committee, good morning. My name is Bessie Martins, and I'm the executive director of Boulder Housing Partners, the housing authority serving the city of Boulder, Colorado. I'm here today in my capacity as the Senior Vice President of the National Association of Housing and Redevelopment Officials. On behalf of NARA's more than 23,000 agency and individual members, I thank the committee and the administration for engaging NARA in this important dialogue. The fundamental premise of TRA is strong and recognizes what NARA and others have suggested as the future of public housing. Nevertheless, NARA has serious concerns regarding the Petra discussion draft. As my colleague from CLAFA underscored, the preservation of public housing's physical assets should be the first and overriding priority of any conversion proposal. Conversion should be entirely voluntary and based on existing programs. To that end, NARA's conversion proposal relies upon Section 8 project-based rental assistance program. Beyond conversion options, PHAs must also have continued access to a fully funded public housing program supported by robust implementation of the Section 30 programs and featuring a streamlined regulatory environment, particularly for small public housing agencies. On this last point, NARA is proudly working side by side with the Public Housing Authority's Directors Association to advance a small PHA reform proposal designed to free small agencies and residents from burdensome regulatory requirements. Turning to PETRA, instead of emphasizing preservation over other priorities, the proposal includes several collateral policy initiatives that would likely inhibit the financial repositioning of public housing. The preservation of converted public housing developments depends upon adequate, stable funding in combination with a rational approach to setting rents. The administration has not made the case regarding PETRA's ability to provide a sustainable funding environment. Because it creates the potential for rents to be adjusted, including decreases, at any time, and because HUD has the unilateral power to force contract extensions, PETRA includes too many disincentives for participation by owners and lenders. Although mobility is desirable and important, PETRA's resident choice option will significantly distort housing choice voucher waiting lists and complicate preservation efforts. This feature risks transforming converted developments into way stations for households seeking tenant-based vouchers. PETRA also allows for the extension of its mobility feature to the entire federally assisted inventory, private and public, converted and unconverted. This overreach could ultimately lead to reductions within the affordable housing inventory. While the consolidation of voucher programs in consortia would not be required under PETRA, regional configurations could still be given a priority by HUD in evaluating applications. Regionalization could become a de facto requirement for participation, a troubling outcome that we should avoid. PETRA leaves too many questions unanswered, making it impossible to evaluate the adequacy of the administration's fiscal year 2011 budget request for TRA. Of primary concern to NARO is the lack of information on financing. NARO is concerned that HUD's leveraging assumptions may be too optimistic and that the proposed amount for year one incremental funding may prove insufficient. Given the concerns NARO and others have raised, including my colleagues on this panel, we would suggest that our conversion proposal represents a more prudent way forward. Under NARO's proposal, PHAs would have the option to voluntarily convert public housing to the existing PBRA program with oversight transferred to HUD's Office of Housing. Given the Office of Housing's less administratively burdensome regulatory environment and lenders' familiarity with the existing PBRA program, conversion under NARO's proposal would provide for a sustainable operating environment and a proven approach to leveraging assets to meet capital needs. Keeping in mind fiscal constraints and an eye on the legislative calendar, NARO suggests initiating the preservation of public housing through voluntary conversion by providing for a pilot program based on our proposal. NARO estimates that a pilot to convert 50,000 public housing units to units assisted through PBRA would require an appropriation of approximately $100 million for fiscal year 2011. NARA has developed legislative language to authorize such a pilot, which we would be pleased to share with you. It is our hope that you will support this approach and communicate that support. Thank you for providing NARA with the opportunity to testify today.
Thank you, Ms. Martinson. Next, we have Ms. Judy Montanez, who is a board member of the National Alliance of HUD Tenants.
Good morning, Chairman Frank and the members of the subcommittee. Thank you for inviting National Alliance of HUD Tenants, NAT, to testify. Since 1992, NAT has represented the 1.3 million families who receive project-based Section 8 in privately owned HUD's multifamily housing. NAT is the only national multifamily tenants union in the United States today with membership in 25 states. Although PETRA will mainly target public housing in this first year, HUD intends to expand it to all HUD-assisted housing, starting with 30,000 privately owned apartments next year, so our membership is directly affected. NAT supports the principles of rent simplification, tenant empowerment, and extension of grievance rights to HUD multifamily tenants and can support the mobility proposal in PETRA with increases in voucher funding. We can also support, in principle, the consolidation of 13 disparate programs into one new funding stream and rental assistance program, provided this is done in the most cost-effective manner as outlined in our written testimony. But the administration's bill falls short of promises to preserve public housing under public ownership with maximum affordability, one-to-one replacement, and guaranteed repairs. Instead, the bill could result in a permanent privatization and loss of nation's system of publicly owned housing by imposing a 30-year use restriction with no requirement to renew and bring in powerful investors and banks into the ownership of these buildings. Unless these problems are corrected, NAT must oppose the Petra proposal. In effect, HUD's bill would bring the whole nightmare of expiring use housing into the nation's system of public housing. For 40 years, HUD multifamily tenants have waged countless struggles, building by building, against rent increases, declining services, substandard conditions, and expiring use restrictions. I've lived in the nightmare firsthand as a tenant in expiring use housing. The Castleton Park Tenants Association in Staten Island, which I co-chair, had to rally 454 families to fight a predatory equity investor who planned to destroy our community for profit. After an accident left me unemployed and disabled, I would have been homeless many times over had I not lived in a subsidized complex. We found ourselves rallying against HUD to enforce the law and begging tenants for donations to pay for the fight to keep our homes safe. Beyond Castleton, this struggle has been a nightmare for the 400,000 families who have lost their affordable housing because HUD and Congress 40 years ago tried to build low-income housing on the more costly devil's bargain with private investors. The nation's investment in those affordable homes has been squandered. Another 200,000 more face expiring mortgages today, an issue which the committee is addressing through H.R. 4868. We urge Congress to not make the same mistake twice. Do not impose the same crisis and struggles of our sisters and brothers in public housing. Any proposal to invest in public housing should require owners and HUD to commit to the longest term use restriction legally allowed. All Petra owners should be required to accept and renew Section 8 subsidy contracts as long as Congress provides funds with no discretion to future secretary. NAT proposes a budget-based subsidy principle like the original project-based Section 8 program, which based subsidy levels on actual operating costs plus capital grants or minimal debt service for required repairs and limited fee for owners. This will achieve transparency and simplification. Petra should also require HUD and owners to maximize capital grant sources to meet these needs, including an increase in public housing modernization grants to preserve housing at the least long-term cost of the federal government. HUD has justified Petra as a means to simplify 13 diverse programs and reduce complexity and confusion, but bringing complexity of multi-housing into public housing will do the opposite. We urge Congress to conduct an independent cost comparison of three funding models outlined in our written testimony to meet public housing repair backlog for embarking on Petra. With these changes, NAT stands ready to work with HUD, Congress, and our tenant leaders for public and voucher housing to realize the positive aspects of Petra to save our home. Thank you.
Next, we have Mr. Maris Reyes, who is the executive director of the good old Lower East Side, and she's on behalf of National People's Action.
Yes. Good morning. Thank you, Chairman Frank, Congresswoman Waters, Congresswoman Velasquez, and members of the committee for inviting me here today to speak about the proposal Petra. My name is Damaris Reyes, and I am a public housing resident and the executive director of Good Old Lower East Side in New York City. I speak to you today on behalf of National People's Action, a network of community organizations from across the country that works to unite everyday people in cities, towns, and rural communities throughout the U.S., including thousands of public housing residents and subsidized housing residents who demand a voice in their housing and a voice in decisions that will affect them. The stated goal of Petra is to streamline funding and policies for all social housing in America. The main advantage of the proposal, we are told, turn our public housing assets into leveraged properties eligible for mortgage to banks. According to HUD, this is necessary because of tens of billions of capital needed to make the needed repairs to our public housing stock. We are here today discussing this bill because this country has starved public housing of necessary resources. It is because previous administrations, Congress, and Congresses as a whole have failed to act. As a country, we have turned our backs on families, the elderly, and the disabled that live in HUD-assisted housing. So now we are looking to the private market to save our public assets. Let us not forget that this is the same private market that just crashed our economy, took billions in taxpayer-funded bailouts, and aren't fixing the mess they created. We cannot throw ourselves on the mercy of the market, and it is imperative that if we propose solutions for filling the gap in capital needs, we do it right. If we go down this road, we won't easily be able to go back. National People's Action does not support Petra in its current form. There are several areas in Petra we feel must be changed and strengthened in order for us to support this bill. We have to ensure that the affordable housing units we have now, a number that is frankly far below the number needed, stay affordable in perpetuity. That the human right and dignity of all public and subsidized housing residents are enshrined into law. And that protections are in place to retain hard housing units and keep units from reverting to the private market via foreclosure or bankruptcy. It would seem that we have not learned anything from the current subsidized housing crisis. Thousands of units are currently bleeding out of the system as landlords who were given subsidized mortgages and tax credit financing reach the end of the contract term that kept the units affordable. As Petra is currently written, converting units would be subject to a 30-year use restriction with a 20-year renewable subsidy contract. We have an opportunity now not to repeat the same mistakes of the past or to literally mortgage our futures. Permanent use restrictions must be included for any conversion plan for public housing. Permanent land use restrictions or land trust arrangements can be written into the law that would maintain the affordability in perpetuity while enabling leverage on the structures themselves. Maintaining hard housing units, Section 8 tenant-based vouchers, are not a replacement for hard, affordable units of housing. Tenant-based vouchers can be a good option for some families as a way to enable mobility and choice, but they should always be in addition to brick-and-mortar units. In the majority of cities and states, it is perfectly legal for landlords to discriminate and refuse to rent an apartment to a family holding a voucher. Vouchers come with hard dollar limits. In some markets, vouchers are extremely difficult to use, for example, on the Lower East Side in New York City. In addition, this proposal should not cause families already on the waiting list to wait any longer. Petra proposed to allow landlords to voucher up to 50% of the hard units that were before conversion publicly owned and permanently affordable units. Under this plan, half of the units could disappear, likely forever. And once the units are gone, our experience is that they don't come back. Section 5D of the Petra draft is particularly disturbing. Properties that convert from public housing buildings to project-based vouchers will only be allowed to retain subsidy on 40% of the units. What is the plan for the other 60% of the tenants who were until conversion living in stable, affordable housing? We need more clarity on this issue. We would never consider mortgaging our national monuments, our park systems, but this proposal seeks to mortgage our nation's homes. The current economic crisis should stand as a sharp reminder of what can happen when the private market is given free rein. It is essential that we put every possible safeguard in place to ensure that these assets are not forfeited to the private ownership through foreclosure or bankruptcy. In the case of bankruptcy or foreclosure, HUD is not compelled to buy the properties back, and there is no guarantee that even if HUD wanted to buy them back, that the money would be available to do so. This is not enough. We must require that all mortgages taken out against converted properties have FHA multifamily insurance on the first lien. Beyond that, strictures must be put in place so that FHA cannot privately market these REOs. HUD must retain its right to own the properties or sell them only to tenants who have organized to purchase their homes. In conclusion, over the last several months, I have been a part of a series of convenings hosted by HUD with public and subsidized residents from around the country. We were told, when you go to sleep at night, it will be public housing. When you wake up in the morning, it will be public housing. It seems that what was meant to be said was that while you may go to sleep in public housing, but there is a nightmare coming. We can do better, and we call on Congress to work with us to make this proposal one that actually can work to increase capital without decreasing opportunity. Thank you.
Next is John Ray, who's the chairman of the New York City Housing Authority.
Chairman Frank, ranking subcommittee member Caputo, Congresswoman Velasquez, and other distinguished members of the committee, I appreciate being given the opportunity to testify today. I am John B. Rea, chairman of the New York City Housing Authority. NYCHA is the country's first and largest housing authority. In May of 1935, 75 years ago, Eleanor Roosevelt opened First Houses, and I am proud to report that First Houses still provides decent, affordable public housing for 126 low-income families. Today, NYCHA operates more than 178,000 units of public housing in 334 developments and provides assistance through Section 8 to more than an additional 250,000 New Yorkers in cooperation with private landlords. If NYCHA was a city, it would rank as the 20th largest in the United States, with more than 650,000 New York City residents served by NYCHA public housing and Section 8 programs. Nearly half of the community that NYCHA serves is made up of working families. Another 42% receive assistance from Social Security, Supplemental Security Income, Veterans Benefits, or a pension. And this population is growing, aging, and diversifying. There is a strong need for additional affordable housing stock in New York. We must build new housing, and we must preserve our existing housing. There is a waiting list in New York City for public housing that includes nearly 131,000 families, and the Section 8 waiting list currently is closed, with an additional 128,000 families waiting for a voucher. So I speak today in support of HUD's Transforming Rental Assistance Initiative. I support Petra's goal of preserving the nation's public housing stock. There is a national backlog of unmet capital needs between $20 to $30 billion, an enormous obstacle to overcome that continues to grow. NYCHA alone has a backlog that is estimated as exceeding $6 billion. Unfortunately, I do not anticipate Congress will provide grant outlays that would address such a large requirement. Although this is a very large amount, it translates into a little more than $35,000 per unit, which is a relatively modest amount, especially compared to replacement costs. Therefore, the best resource to address these capital needs is to use our assets and long-term financial assistance agreements to leverage private market funding. Only by engaging the private markets and using all of our assets will housing authorities be able to preserve the national investment that has been made in public housing. Transforming Rental Assistance mirrors New York City Mayor Michael R. Bloomberg's new housing marketplace plan to create or preserve 165,000 affordable housing units by 2014. The city is well on its way to achieving the mayor's target with 100,000 units already created or preserved. With HUD assistance, NYCHA has converted 2,200 apartments from public housing to Section 8 voucher assistance and plans to convert up to an additional 6,200 more. We also federalized 20,000 public housing units by leveraging federal stimulus funding to access $400 million in public and private market funding. Residents will continue to pay 30% of their rent income under Petra. The contract rent must cover reasonable operating costs, including a management fee, debt service on previous capital borrowings, the cost of newly accrued capital needs as identified in each agency's five-year capital plan, and an initial reserve for replacement. I am concerned that under Petra, HUD appears to have a sole authority to increase or decrease contract rent. My suggestion is to refer to data submitted by the local housing authorities, including independent studies of the local rental markets, and let that data play a significant role when determining the levels of contract rent. Any private market capital financing should be insured by the Federal Housing Administration or should be subject to a government guarantee. I support Chairman Frank's draft of the Public Housing Preservation and Rehabilitation Act that includes a full faith and credit guarantee. I also support the preservation bill's proposed provision of grants in lieu of tax credits for the rehabilitation of qualifying public housing. I support the basic concept for one-for-one replacement. Petra provides greater flexibility than we have seen in other measures on the same issue. I support the bill's provision on allowing replacement units off-site, within the neighborhood or within the metropolitan area. It is important that this should be done in consideration of fair housing standards and the need to deconcentrate poverty. There may be situations when one-for-one replacement is not appropriate. I support the bill's provision on using tenant-based vouchers in narrow circumstances. I support allowing portability after 24 months of residence. However, I am concerned about the one-out-of-three provision that would allow one-third of turnover vouchers to be held in reserve for families that may one day opt to move. This would be unfair to all households on the waiting list for Section 8. My suggestion is to draw portability from an annual appropriation of incremental vouchers or from the tenant protection account. Petra incorporates Section 3, and I support passage of Representative Velasquez's Earnings and Living Opportunity Act to reform Section 3. Resident Opportunity or Support Services, known as ROS, authorizes a full range of job training and employment opportunities, If we're serious about resident employment, it is time for Ross to be funded separately at $1 billion, with the vast majority going to job training and resident employment initiatives. The Transforming Rental Assistance Initiative is a multi-year program. The current public housing and Section 8 programs will continue for years to come. I urge Congress to provide housing authorities with the flexibility to administer their current portfolios, including full fungibility between their capital funding, operating funding, and Section 8 funding, allowing housing authorities with this excess cash flow to use these funds to cover debt and address its capital needs. I have prepared formal responses to your earlier questions and would like to submit them for the record as well. Thank you.
And Mr. Martell, who's already been introduced by the ranking member of the subcommittee, Mr. Taylor.
Thank you, Chairman Frank. Chairman Frank, ranking member Capito, members of the committee, my name is Mark Taylor. I'm the executive director of the Charleston All House Authority located in Charleston, West Virginia. I'm honored to present our views regarding the administration's TRA proposal. I want to thank my representative, Congresswoman Shelley Moore Capito, for the invitation to testify on this important and ambitious proposal. TRA, if authorized, will have a profound impact for housing authorities like mine. I want to acknowledge the commendable effort made by the department to gather comments on this proposal from stakeholders. There remain, however, a number of unanswered questions. Charleston Canal Housing Authority is the largest assisted agency in West Virginia. We provide housing assistance to more than 4,400 families. We manage 12 public housing communities serving more than 2,000 residents, and we manage over 2,900 rental assistance vouchers serving nearly 7,000 residents. We are changing the face of public housing in our area by redeveloping our three oldest communities, all of which are more than 50 years old. This is being done using private and public financial resources, including utilizing low-income housing tax credits, leveraging one-third of our capital funds, and accessing private loans. This effort will result in 500 public housing and project-based units. We estimate our modernization needs for preserving our nine remaining housing communities to be as much as $84 million over the next 20 years. With this in mind, we will need a variety of tools to enable us to preserve our remaining stock of affordable housing and produce desperately needed new units. I believe the conversion of public housing to a known and reliable form of assistance like project-based rental assistance, assuming it remains voluntary, moves us in the right direction. At my housing authority, the conversion to project-based assistance would likely succeed for smaller developments, 50 to 100 units, which are less than 30 years old and have more modern design features. Securing modest financing for modernization upgrades would be relatively simple. Larger 100-plus unit developments that are more than 40 years old with outdated designs would not be viable for conversion without either major redevelopment or modernization funding as provided through the capital funds. We've been very fortunate in the time and resources available to us to redevelop our aging developments, including $4 million in NSP funds and $6 million in TCAP funds. While I only have limited information regarding the proposed ADN program, I am concerned about the acceptance of the marketplace, especially the lending community, given the number of secondary policy objectives ADN would impose. The imposition of Section 3 requirements, community service, fair hearings upon converted developments are all examples of well-intended policy goals not required in the private sector, all of which will add costs. With regard to resident choice feature in the current proposal, my immediate concern is that it essentially allows clients who are already receiving rental assistance to jump the voucher waiting list and receive one out of every three vouchers that become available, which in our housing authority's case would be approximately 150 vouchers annually. We currently have over 2,000 families on the voucher waiting list with our average wait approximately 12 to 18 months. Unfortunately, 150 fewer of these unassisted families per year would not receive assistance under this proposal. Public housing residents in my housing authority clearly have choice. Approximately 25% of our residents choose to leave their units annually. In this past year, about 66 of those residents were provided the opportunity to receive a voucher, and they also had the opportunity to transfer to other public housing sites. Therefore, public housing residents are no more constrained in their housing choices than any other low-income families. With respect to regionalization, while the voluntary consolidation of housing choice voucher programs or the adoption of multi-agency portability agreements would not be required in the current proposal, I believe using this as grounds for qualification will lead to regionalization becoming a requirement for participation. The decision to enter into a regional agreement should be left to local authorities. I think PHAs, including my own, would be far more likely to enter the cooperative agreements if the department implemented statutory language that increased flexibility through regulatory administrative measures. Mr. Chairman, I believe at this point there are far too many unanswered questions concerning TRA. For example, it's my understanding the department's proposal will be phased in over the next several years. Assuming this remains a voluntary program, what can those who do not convert expect? What will the department continue to request capital fund resources sufficient to address the ongoing modernization needs for those who do not convert? There also seems to be no consideration for the authorities that have currently obligated their capital funds for preservation efforts in the current capital fund financing program. Will we be able to access replacement housing factor funds? In conclusion, who would administer the set-aside pool of resident choice vouchers? Where will housing authorities that do not administer housing choice vouchers but are required to exercise resident choice obtain exit vouchers? The revised CRA proposal presently does not provide details on key elements that authorities like mine need to know. Should you choose to advance conversion legislation this year, I would strongly suggest first implementing a pilot to assess its merits in a variety of markets. Thank you for this opportunity to testify, and I'm happy to take questions that you may have.
Thank you, and this has been very useful, and this is obviously a very major step. We have the Choice Neighborhoods Bill before us, and we have already voted out of this committee the SEVRA bill, the reform of vouchers. As a practical matter, I think it is unlikely that we will also, in the remaining time this year, given that this committee has spent so much time on financial reform, be able to finalize any action on this, but we want to get it started. And I appreciate the Secretary's fundamental impulse here, which is to get more money into public housing, because it is a shame that we have done so little for the poorest people. But I have my fundamental question. I'll ask you all to think about this. I worry about a situation in which units that are now owned publicly are foreclosed upon and become privately owned. I think that raises serious issues constitutionally of the diminution of rights you have against the public entity versus the private entity. I think mayors might feel somewhat different about this. There are mayors who now have large numbers of public housing units in their city. The mayors, in my experience, have some influence over who's head of the public housing authority. These would now be purely privately owned. There is the question about how long it stays there. And part of the dilemma here is what my colleague from Texas, who's sitting in the ranking member's chair, now mentioned. To the extent that you write safeguards in for the tenants, you to some extent diminish the incentive to lend. So what I would ask people to work on is this. I appreciate the importance of getting more money in. I strongly agree with the witness who suggested that we shouldn't have to do this, but we do. But is there a way to access the private market that incentivizes loans but does not put public ownership of this asset at risk? And I will be very reluctant to do that. The public hasn't been a great trustee, but I think abandoning the whole notion that the public has some role here would be a mistake and is unlikely in the long term to work. So let me ask preliminarily, are there things we could do that could incentivize private lending? And going to project-based Section 8 is not a problem to me. The problem and getting accessing private capital is obviously an advantage. The concern that I have is that if the price of accessing private capital is to put public ownership at risk, that may be too high a price. Do any of the witnesses have any ideas about how we might access private capital in this way with alternative forms of security other than taking over public housing authority, which I must say to many lenders probably wouldn't be their first choice for how to spend their time anyway. The notion that you get to be the housing authority isn't one that is necessarily going to unlock great pools of capital. But does anyone have any ideas about that?
Chairman Frank, my view on this is the biggest risk to foreclosure is too much leverage on these properties. The one way to approach this with not dealing with your immediate issue about not having a risk of foreclosure and the private market having ownership in public housing is to ensure that the underwriting standards in which private investors and banks would participate in don't put an
But I agree with that, but as you said, that wasn't my question. I don't mean to be rude, but I'd rather talk about my question. That is a dilemma. Now, again, there may be other ways to do that. It may involve alternative guarantees. But I did want to be clear, that's my approach to this. Mr. Gleason.
Mr. Chairman, I think your questions to the Secretary and your comments today hit this issue right on point. I don't think as they currently...
Well, I'm glad someone did.
I don't think there is a perfect solution as the market currently works. I think your suggestion just now about alternative guarantees are probably the only way that you can ensure that will take place. It would seem that those guarantees to ensure that there is public ownership after the fact would have to come from a public entity guaranteeing that something like that.
Well, I agree. Look, I think, and again, my colleague from Texas question started out, I'm afraid of falling between two stools, of writing in so many protections for the tenants, which I support, that nobody wants to lend them the money, or incentivizing the lending the money at the price of not having the protection of the tenants. And that's what leads me to think of a third way. The gentleman from Texas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to ask unanimous consent to submit a letter signed by 9 multifamily housing providers.
Without objection, so ordered. I have a list here from Public Housing Authority Director Mr. Rod Solomon, the Massachusetts Union of Public Housing Tenants, 19 Urban Academics, the Multifamily Housing Industry, the Los Angeles Housing and Human Rights, the Los Angeles Coalition and Hunger and Homeless, Chicago Housing and Human Rights, others list, which will be made public. I ask unanimous consent to insert their submissions in the record without objection. So ordered, and whoever gave me this thoughtfully added at the end for me an instruction that says, to close the hearing, say this hearing is adjourned, and bang, gavel. And I appreciate being so... I appreciate being so instructed, but whoever wrote that should say, but don't do it too soon, stupid. The gentleman from Texas now recognized.
Mr. Taylor, you've also raised concerns about how lenders would respond to a new and an untested program. Have you had any opportunity to visit with lenders about this and what effect it would have?
No, I have not visited with lenders at this point. In other transactions we've done thus far, they're more familiar with the project-based voucher. I can tell you when we close those deals on the onset, they're very interested in getting those contracts in hand that are signed that commits those funds to those units for the first 20 years with that renewal. I'm not sure what their response would be to this. And my concern in Charleston is that it would slow our process down. We're in the middle of redeveloping these housing authorities or these housing properties. And I'm concerned changing to this new type voucher, they may kind of back off some.
You've expressed some concerns about the mobility in a clause in TRA. What would you suggest as an alternative to the administration proposal to address the matter?
I'm not real fond of the choice component. I understand it. A person with a tenant-based voucher already has the right after a year to move, and they can port their voucher to other states. That program is working. And also in the project-based unit, after a year, that tenant can choose to get a tenant-based voucher and relocate as well. And that system seems to be working fine.
Okay, thank you. Is it Koenig? You've indicated and you signed a letter that says that your industry group characterizes the changes by the administration as being an undefined hybrid of the project-based voucher system. Can you explain to the committee what you mean by that?
Well, essentially, they really haven't given a great deal of detail on exactly how they expect all of this to take place. We've got the sort of framework for how they anticipate some of these attributes of the conversion of the program to take place, but they haven't really told us all of the attributes of how they anticipate it will shape up. For instance, they really don't explain where they will get forward funding from for the capital, where they will get other funding from, and they really don't explain all of the rules and regulations they intend to modify and change going forward. It's not transparent.
Do you believe that it places too much discretion in the hands of the HUD secretary?
Absolutely.
And believe that that will have a chilling effect on any syndication or any group of people that traditionally put together these housing deals?
Yes, I do.
Is that your major client?
Yes, it is.
And do your clients have any ideas about how this capital could be put into the public system to their satisfaction that would create this balancing act that the chairman has talked about?
Well, right now, the system that they're working with, my public housing clients, they're working with their replacement housing factor and their capital funds, and they're blending that with the existing programs that are available. So they're utilizing things like tax credits, green community funding, and other opportunities to do preservation and create opportunities that are available to them. So there are existing tools that they're using to preserve their stock.
Do they access the tax-exempt financing?
Yes, they use the tax-exempt bond financing.
Through the state housing finance program. So, and they're using that in addition to the tax credits?
Yes, they get the 4% credits that back into the bond program. And then they balance that with the additional funds they have access to.
The last question would be, if you convert public to private, do you have any property tax issues that would raise the expenses on a project, whereas a project now might have a tax-exempt status and have no property tax liability, whereas if you put it into private hands, you would have an immediate, the expense would go up immediately, and that would be a big burden on the system?
Well, first I would say in many cases, public housing authorities pay a pilot to their communities, so they have some tax requirements, real estate tax requirements. When you modify and include a tax credit to it, there are a lot of states that have some sort of element written into their tax code that have a modified structure so that there is a tax component that does apply to the property itself. Most of the time, the public housing authority is the sponsor, so it's not technically privatizing because they've brought in their private entity as a minor member, and they hold ownership and retain ownership, and it converts to them after the 15-year compliance period.
Well, with cities, counties, school districts, states being strapped right now, I would suggest that if there's our major changes to this program, that state legislatures may begin to look at and use this as an opportunity to kind of come back in and redefine their exempt status on some of these projects.
I'd agree.
Gentlewoman from New York.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I would like to take this opportunity to welcome my constituent from New York, Damaris Reyes. Damaris, if I may, I would like to address my first question to you, and I would like Ms. Montanez, to comment on it. According to Secretary Donovan, PETRA will strengthen tenants' rights and those of tenants' organizations in all properties, not just those at greatest risk of losing project-based assistance. Do you agree with the Secretary's assertion? And if not, what should we do to strengthen tenant rights going forward?
So we worked with HUD, and we do feel that there was a considerable amount of work that was done to include some of our suggestions regarding resident and tenant rights. There were a few minor issues around organizing. For example, like there's no clarity around the tenant participation funds, which are essential in helping folks to organize. Mm-hmm. And so there's not a dollar amount, and the program itself is at the discretion of the secretary, and with all due respect, secretaries change, and so does political will, right? And so in those areas, we're a little concerned. I think there were some places where we missed opportunities. For example, where folks who have been involved in activities on or off properties that become ineligible for public housing, that can be evicted, and those we should have commented or tried to address those issues for those families, and we didn't address that, or like community service and things like that. So there were some good things, but you know, there's still some questions, in particular around the grievance procedures.
Do you have anything else to add? Your mic is not on.
Thank you. I think both public housing and multifamily housing have a very strong present right to organize regulations, the 245, 964. Mm-hmm. And I think they should stay strongly in place. Most of us agree that we have many of the aspects of those regulations can be coordinated together as one. The $25 funding, it should be in place, but it has to be very clear that it needs to be completely independent of owners and public housing employees and management agents, so that there would be no interference and no conflict of interest, as well as the resources for organizers and tenants should be also independent of organizers, and that would strengthen right to organize.
Great, thank you. Mr. Rhea and Mr. Taylor. Petra applies the current requirements of the Section 3 program to converted properties. What kind of changes do you suggest to the Section 3 program under this new subsidy scenario to maximize economic opportunities for low-income tenants?
My reference to Section 3 wasn't so much a better way of implementation of it, and we actually have a Section 3 plan, and with our redevelopment, we do our best and our utmost to encourage folks in our community to apply for these jobs and make sure they're aware of them and monitor contractors. My point, bringing that up in my testimony, was just to say that while we do these programs in public housing and we're required to do these programs and we do them, there's an added cost to that. If we're to be funded like the private sector, I think it's something the private sector doesn't face that we do.
A couple of things, obviously, as we've discussed this before, there's no current funding in place for implementing Section 3 on the part of public housing authorities, so it's an unfunded mandate that requires a substantial amount of investment.
But it will have a great economic impact for the local housing authorities, in the sense that if you have a person that is unemployed and live in public housing, get training and then unemployed, will make their income, will have a better revenues for, generate better revenues for.
Well, I strongly, and I'm sure all my colleagues strongly support the ideals of Section 3, and we've done a lot of the New York City Housing Authority implement it. We spend $5 million a year on implementing Section 3 with no actual funding from HUD or from Congress to implement the program. So it's not an issue of do we have the will or the commitment to it. It's how can you support it and sustain it in light of the other constraints. The other piece is that when we look at job training and the things that will move people to work and take them from underemployment to better jobs and better wages, that has a substantial cost beyond what the housing authority on its own can do. And so we've worked on developing partnerships with not-for-profits and with the private sector that's focused on training residents and low-income Americans to put them to work. So we think partnerships and ways to encourage partnerships could be an important piece of this. And lastly, as I mentioned in my formal testimony, we believe funding of ROS is the best direct way to do it. That program was set up to ensure that there's a support for residents economically, and we would suggest that that's the place.
Thank you.
Gentleman from West Virginia.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Taylor, you heard me ask the question of the Secretary, a point that you raised in your written testimony about the extension of 20 years of obligations that you put forth in the very good replacement and regeneration of public housing, and I commend you. You're doing a great job. The way I heard his remark was that this will free up more for development in a commercial, maybe some commercial availabilities within the housing units or near and around. How did you interpret what he said, and does it ease your mind a little bit in some of the concerns that you raised in your written testimony?
Actually, it doesn't, because my concern is, in my testimony, what I'm saying is we leverage one-third of our future capital funds over a 20-year period. currently, our housing authority receives about $2.1 million annually in capital funds. But over the next 20 years right now, we'll be repaying back $600,000 of those funds. And those funds kind of come in what we call clumped together. They're not assigned to any one development. So if the capital fund decreases, we get whatever is allotted to us minus that $600,000, which I will have to have those funds to maintain the rest of the housing development.
So your concern is on, as he said, that decreasing the capital fund by $300 million, that would decrease your whatever your, yeah. And are you going to be able to meet the mortgage payments that you've extended for the, or the payments that you've extended over the last 20 years?
Right.
Am I understanding that?
You are. And I'm not sure that we would actually even have an option to convert in this, because when we signed that loan, we agreed, Fannie Mae actually was our lender in this case.
Oh, that's good.
But we agreed not to decrease our public housing units because it's a formula program.
Right.
For the capital fund.
Okay, thank you for that. Also, on the one-to-one replacement, we've kind of gone back and forth in this in Charleston, just in a very small way. I can't imagine, Mr. Ray, what you go through in your units. Your numbers are so much greater than ours. How do you feel about one-to-one replacement, and do you have the flexibility now and in this bill to be able to either make the decisions to move them in different regions, different areas, different income groups? How do you see that?
Well, my concern about the one-for-one replacement is we're piecemealing our developments to get them done. And typically in West Virginia, because a lot of our tax credit, the 9%, will allow us only to do about 44 units at a time. When we close those deals, I just don't know that I can commit to if I'm tearing some units down at that time or demolishing units, that I can actually commit to replace those units at that point given in time.
Mm-hmm.
It's the board's goal of the housing authority is to replace the maximum number of units that we can back to our original configuration.
Right.
But when we close a deal with a lender and all the parties at the table, I just can't confirm on that date by a given specific time in the future that I could replace those units one for one. And we don't want to replace back on site because our oldest developments that we're redeveloping, it's too dense.
Right.
And it's better and safer for our residents if we de-densify someone.
Right. Does anybody else have a comment on the one for one replacement? Because this has got a – do you have a comment?
Yes, obviously many of us are faced with legacy communities that have strong concentrations of low income and poverty. We believe that the flexibility that's written in the proposal is prudent in that it allows for one-for-one replacement at the site, but also to have one-for-one replacement in other locations, which allows you to bring in other families that would have the effect of deconcentrating poverty in our existing housing authority locations, as well as allow us to build new housing in locations where acquisition of land costs and other things are less prohibitive, ultimately allowing you to bring new units on cheaper and to work with some of the other objectives of economic deconcentration. So we think that this is actually a move forward.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Martins, this is a big question for not much time. You've commented in your testimony about what you feel are misaligned priorities of the administration concerning preservation and conversion. Can you help us understand why you question that and how you'd like to see those changes?
Yes. So our understanding of PETRA is that the goals are noble and good and very broad. And, you know, what we understand that in this society, there are always competing values, and we always try to have it all. And having it all often gives us consequences that are unintended. So our overarching statement is that preservation must come first. PETRA talks about goals of preservation, streamlining programs, consolidating programs, creating opportunities for residents. And our point is that we really need to make an incremental step, because as the committee members have expressed today, the risk of loss is too great to make a mistake. So what we were talking about is, first, the overriding priority of migrating public housing to a real estate platform, getting it stabilized, and from there addressing the rest of the concerns that are the right ones, creating efficiencies, creating opportunity for residents.
Gentleman from Missouri.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Connie, I was intrigued by your statement earlier about pilots. In places where that occurs, who would be responsible for the pilots?
It's
you repeat the question? I'm not sure I heard it.
You mentioned in some communities they pay payments in lieu of taxes.
Payments in lieu of taxes. A number of the housing authorities that I work with in Wisconsin, their agreement with their communities is that they will pay a pilot.
For the school district?
They pay to support the basic infrastructure where they hold housing. So they do not pay the normal assessment that they would pay for any other entity if they were a for-profit entity. They pay a payment in lieu that supports the basic right. school district and water and utility firefighting elements. So.
I'm a former mayor, we just generally did that for, tax abatements, tax increment financing, that kind of thing. And
it is fairly common for your public entities to have an agreement with their local governments to pay the basic levels to support that infrastructure.
Mm-hmm. It's Ms. Martin.
Could I add to that? Because we have done something similar in Boulder where we have an agreement with our local government to essentially parse the pilot so that schools and fire safety and the essential services are paid,
right.
and then the rest of it is not, because the margins of managing affordable housing are so thin that we're looking for every increment.
Well, that's why I was surprised
I
at
agree
it, because
Ms. Koenig, that the parsing of pilot, I think, is not uncommon.
Yes, yeah. To those of you who operate housing authorities, do you think that this issue of mobility, the mobility option, is a way for us to finally achieve scattered site housing? Mr. Grisano?
Is this on?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I think the mobility question is really one of fairness. There are thousands of people on the waiting list for Section 8, and they too want to have mobility. They too want to have affordable and decent housing. So I would make a modest proposal to modify this currently written bill to say that if people are in developments that are converted from public housing to this new model, that they certainly can apply for Section 8 and be put on the waiting list like everybody else. And then that way, their name would come to the top of the list in the same time frame that somebody else's would. So that the notion that somebody after 2 years would go would trump other people who have been on the list for several years, I think is problematic. We certainly embrace the notion of choice, but it should be equitably delivered. So I think if we just say if your development is converted, you simply apply, which you can do anyway, for the Section 8 program, your name will move up the list naturally. The other point I would say about that is, If it's within the public housing inventory and some portion of the portfolio has been converted and some has not, there could be provisions to allow people to move from a converted site to a non-converted site within the public housing authority's portfolio, assuming there were vacant units. Because currently, you can apply to transfer from one development to another. There's no reason why we couldn't modify that to say you could go from a former public housing site that was converted to another site that is still public housing. So there are ways to deal with this that are equitable.
But do we have a challenge? One of the problems, at least when we've tried scattered site housing in the past, is that when we go to the private market, the Section 8 voucher is not sufficient to live anywhere except another low-income neighborhood.
Well, we've had actually very good. I can't tell what that's on.
No, you're fine.
Yeah, we've had very good success actually with people using their vouchers to move, not only throughout the city but the metropolitan area of Baltimore. You do have to pay a higher rent in those areas, and so therefore you have to have that flexibility on the rent standard.
All right, Ms. Koenig.
I think when you ask the question about mobility, this choice that they're offering doesn't actually open up changes to how someone will access housing in the greater nation All it does is move people up, jump them up in front of people who are waiting. It doesn't change their access to housing around the nation. It just allows them to say, I no longer want to be here, and now I get one out of the next three available, so now the people who have been waiting have to wait longer. It doesn't change their ability to find other housing choices.
Yeah, I agree. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I'm going to go one more round, because Mr. Taylor, you intrigued me. You said you have a loan from Fannie Mae. What kind of loan?
Fannie Mae has a product called Modernization Express. And
called what?
Modernization Express. That's just the product name. But HUD allows you now, there's a capital fund financing program we call CFFP. And again, it's where you leverage one-third of your capital funds. And when we put that out for bid, and it may speak to lenders interested in this, I'm not sure. But when we put that out for bid, we had two responses. We had one from Fannie Mae, and I think the other one was from Bank of America.
And which one did you take?
We took the Fannie Mae because it was a contracted time. They had a product that was more readily approved.
When was this?
We did this. We closed it actually last summer, but it's been in process since 2004. We've been working on that deal that long.
And is that a useful product, you think, that Fannie Mae has?
Very useful.
Do you think we could abolish that product before we come up with a replacement?
Excuse me?
Could we abolish their ability to offer that product without coming up with a replacement?
I don't think so. I like the product.
I hope you're inspired some others.